Hi Nick, thanks for joining us today.
Oh, my pleasure.
We've been asking members of the Wallace & Gromit website to submit their questions to you as kind of a 20th anniversary celebration. So we've picked out 20 of the most weird and wonderful questions to ask you today. Shall we start off with an easy one?
Yeah.
The first one comes in from Parley, and they say, what was your inspiration behind creating Wallace & Gromit?
Probably Tintin at the time was a very big influence. The Tintin cartoons and the voyage to the moon. And I loved... you know, the way Hergé drew graphic things like cars and, you know, underwater submarines and, you know, the rocket. In fact, the techno trousers, you can see the influence of the spacesuits in Tintin. But it was just a funny idea I had, really. I was at National Film and TV School and thought of this funny idea of a guy who builds the rocket in his basement. And that was the joke, really. And then Gromit came along and developed into a dog from a cat. So it all went from there.
Okay, the second question is from Bridget SF, and she says, do any of your characters represent your own personality? And if so, which one?
I think there's probably a bit of me in both Wallace and Gromit. And I relate probably more strongly to Gromit as a character. The way he's... I was always fairly quiet as a youngster. And thought a lot, you know, and was quite sensitive. So I can relate very much to Gromit. And Wallace, you know, I'm full of just ideas, you know, so I like to just get on, you know, think of things and do them and don't think enough, perhaps, you know, of the consequences. But, you know, bite off a lot more than I can chew. But my dad was very similar to Wallace. So I think there's family traits in there as well. He used to work in his shed making things all the time.
The next question is from Kieran, who asks, what Wallace and Gromit animation is your favourite and why?
It's probably got to be The Wrong Trousers, I think. There was something about that story, I think, that just fitted nicely into half an hour. It wasn't too rushed. It had its own pace. And it was full of kind of new ideas, you know, that... After Grand Day Out, which was a bit more, you know, less of a story in a way, this was my first stab at doing a proper story, and it was like a lot of films that I loved, at heist movies, you know, stealing things from museums and a villain, you know, a bit like Alfred Hitchcock movies where there's a stranger staying in the spare room, a mysterious stranger, and I loved the way Steve Box did the Penguin. It was very economic in a way, but very effective.
All right, so this question is from W&G Fan 21, and they ask, did you ever think Wallace and Gromit would be so popular? And what was it like to win your first Oscar?
Gosh, I never really knew that Wallace and Gromit were going to be so popular. I'm still, in a way, I feel like that student who just came up with a silly idea. And I can't believe that now they're a household name. You know, it's taken 20 years for it to become that way. So it's not been an overnight success.
The next question comes in from Gromit Lad. And he says, I was browsing on the internet and saw a topic about you planning a second movie. Is this true?
Well, I am writing more films all the time. You know, I've got ideas in the back of my head all the time. I've got two or three which could be possible films. I don't know if I'm going to do them as a movie, as a full-length movie for the cinema. They could be half an hour's, you know, like the last one, like Wrong Trousers or, you know, Matter of Loaf and Death. I somehow think that they suit... I may come up with an idea that changes my mind, but I think they suit the half-hour TV slot slightly better, I think.
This question comes in from Gromit fan Mark. And he says, I've always wondered what age Wallace and Gromit are. Do you know yourself, or do you think it's best not to say?
It's one of those things. It's because they're kind of fictional characters that are a bit ageless, really. A bit like the time they live in. Is it 70s? Is it 80s? You know, is it 60s? Is it present day? You know, I never like to pin myself down or where they live exactly, you know, which town. I used to think Wallace was about 50, But now that I've turned 50, I think he's quite a lot old. I always think he's quite a lot older than me. So, I couldn't tell you really, to be honest. I'd rather keep it vague.
I've got another question here from Gromit and Fluffles. And they said, are there any plans to bring back Fluffles?
There could be. We've had quite a bit of, letters and people blogging about Fluffles. I haven't got a specific plan with Fluffles yet, but I think she could be the one character that does come back, actually. I'm hesitant to bring others back because they exist in those films and it keeps them kind of special. Except Shaun the Sheep, of course, has got his own series. So, whether Fluffles will get her own series, I'm not sure, but she may appear again as Gromit's girlfriend.
The next question we've got is from W&G Fan 21, and they said that they enjoyed Wrong Trousers the most. But how did you get the idea of having the penguin as the villain?
It was an idea where there were going to be lots of penguins. It was going to be a really cold winter, and even though I got my geography, penguins come from the South Pole. I had artistic license. I've got an artistic license in my pocket. Actually, I can show any time. And it was really cold winter, and all these penguins migrate from the North Pole, and they stopped by at Wallace and Gromit's house. But it just seemed better in the end, when it came to writing the script, that to have one penguin than hundreds. And it was I was playing on Alfred Hitchcock is this director of fantastic thrillers, and I had this idea about the stranger staying in the spare room, who was, and all these slapstick gags using household objects in a penguin, like vacuum cleaners and things. And then somebody said to me, "Oh, what if he was a villain? You know, what would that do to the story?" And it suddenly went in a really good direction as a tense kind of thriller. And then Steve Box, my colleague, animated the penguin, and we decided not to do him in the usual cartoony way, don't give him a waddle in his walk, or, not that realistic, actually. But to make him more, we used to talk him about him being like a milk bottle floating along, because it would be much more sinister, and just blink, just turn his head in slightly robotic fashion and just blink. And that made him much more sinister. And it was just funny, the idea of because everyone thinks penguins are cute, to have a sinister penguin.
Okay, the next question comes in from Crow, and they ask, what made you decide that Gromit didn't need a mouth?
Because he did have a mouth. There are early sketches, you can probably see where Gromit has a mouth. And it was really economy. I was making a grand day out, and I actually recorded a voice for him as well. And I just found it when I did the first shot of Gromit. It was a lot of work to move the mouth, so I just did away with it, because you couldn't see it from the angle we were at anyway. So I just didn't bother. As soon as I started moving his eyebrow, that seemed to speak volumes, and it just didn't need a mouth at all. And it suddenly created Gromit's character as we know him, as a kind of quiet, introverted, but very intelligent dog. Which was the opposite of Wallace. So it suddenly created a nice duo, nice dynamic.
Okay, the next question is from Fish, and they ask, why did you change Gromit's appearance after a grand day out?
It wasn't deliberate, actually. It's one of those things, like when you see early Mickey Mouse drawings or films and compare them with the more later stuff. It's just something, things change over time. I think because Gromit looks quite like banana-shaped nose, really, like look quite long, and then the gap between his eyes and his nose is much greater. I think over the years I've just tried to make him a bit more cuter and a bit more more using round shapes, I think. And it just happens because you make them a million times and they just sort of evolve, really, over time.
There's an interesting one coming from Jimmy P, who said, I always wanted to know how the cooker got up to the moon and why it was coin-operated.
it was partly to do with being a student and not really caring too much about the logic of things. I had a script, actually, that was far longer for a grand day out to start with, and because it was taking me so many years, I had to sort of pare it right down and I just thought, why not, really? Why shouldn't he? I can't really explain, to be honest. I just thought it was quite funny that there is, you know, some kind of caretaker, but he's coin operated, was a sort of one of those funny, what do you call them, dichotomies or problems, you know, that because you get slot machines and those machines a lot in kind of cartoons and things.
The next question comes in from Marcus L, and he asks, are there any new animation techniques you would like to learn and develop?
We do a lot of computer animation here at Aardman, and I don't know much about it. I have often wanted just to learn how to do it, you know. But I'm also at the same time very happy with plasticine. You know, I think that will always be my technique that I love, really, because I think for me a lot of the humour actually comes out of the fact that it's plasticine. Not you know, I'm in great admiration of many CGI films. There are many people who are really good at it, both here and at Pixar and, you know, and places. So, and all over the industry these days. But in a way, I think to stick with plasticine makes us different, you know, and makes it's still very special. I think it's becoming more special the more people do CGI, so I don't have a reason to step out of it.
We've got another question here from Alex Crichton, who wants to get into animating or being a model maker. And they asked, did you take any courses, or was it just something that you picked up naturally?
It did come to me naturally, in a way. I just sort of experimented on my own at home, you know, as a hobby. Very much on my parents' 8mm camera. One day I discovered had a stop frame button, you know, a button that takes one picture at a time rather than constant running as film cameras do. And so I practiced a lot at home with cartoons, with cutout drawings, cutouts, and with plasticine and any household objects. I would move them around, animate them, but also. I then went to college. You know, I applied for a place at Sheffield. It was called Sheffield Polytechnic then. Now it's called Sheffield Hallam University. And the art school there has a very good film course. And they let me do my animation, really, in the corner. There weren't many animators.
We've got another question here from Moongoon. And they ask, what is the greatest advice you've ever received in regards to animation?
You know, I used to do animation as a hobby at home and you know, make films on my own in the attic, you know, in the garden shed. And I remember my dad saying, why don't you apply to college, you know, find out where to do a film course or an animation course, because you could do a degree in film or animation. That was probably one of the best bits of advice I ever got.
The next question comes from Criticamp Mum. And she asks, given your existing use of animals in your work, what is your favourite animal?
It's a difficult one, that. Probably penguins do come pretty high, actually. I've always loved animals. I've never had a cat or a dog, strangely enough. Gromit is the dog I never had, I think. I do like dogs and pets, you know, generally. I had guinea pigs and chipmunks and goldfish. Still got a lot of goldfish in the pond. But I like wildlife a lot as well. I'm very thrilled to see a badger just near my house the other day. So I've never seen one there before.
We've got a question here from Chris2009. And he says, have you ever thought of giving up animation and moving into something else?
Many times. How many times a day do I think of that? No, I feel very lucky to be actually doing something I enjoy so much, and I still kind of feel guilty that I'm getting paid for it. You know, somebody's going to find out one day, you know, that I'm having a good time.
The next question comes in from ConCon, and he asks, before you became an animator, did you want to do any other jobs as a child?
Well, I think it was a range of, because I always thought art was, I didn't in a way take it very seriously as a career. I thought, you know, as was the thing at the time, really, a job was going out and getting a proper job, you know, where you're on a building site or working at the local factory or whatever it was. And I thought art was like for people sat by waterfalls painting pictures and, you know. But very early on, when I was interested in drawing cartoons, I wanted to work for the Beano. That was my ideal job, drawing cartoons for the Beano. And so I did sort of fantasize about doing that for a while.
This interesting question comes in from Pearl Barker, and she says that she dreams in colour, even though she doesn't see in colour. Do you dream of Wallace and Gromit? And if so, what do you dream?
I don't think I do dream of Wallace and Gromit. I do dream a lot, actually. And I think I do dream in colour. I once had a dream that actually had credits at the end. And I knew it was in colour because it had Technicolour, only credits.
That's not a lot of detail.
I'm obviously getting too involved with films.
Okay, so the next one comes in from Odalisk, and they ask, when you worked with Julian Knott on the music for your films, do you give any suggestions to him, or do you just simply hand him the script and let him have a go at it himself?
It's wonderful that I've met Julian Knott. You know, we met at film school, actually. He was a student of you can do different things at film school, and he was in the kind of music composition department. And, Julian likes to get the finished film, really. We've usually shot everything, and it's all edited, and he looks at that, because otherwise, if we hadn't finished the edit, all the timings would change for his music. So he likes to look at the finished picture and write music for that. And I think at the beginning, I didn't say a lot to him, really. I told him the kind of films I was aspiring to in the films. And he sort of got the picture, really, and wrote it off his own, you know, pretty much with very little direction. These days, I'm probably a bit more... I don't know much about music, you see, but I probably have learned quite a bit over the years, and so now I'm probably a bit more in his face, you know. But no, he still pretty much gets on with it, and it's all from him, so, and it's brilliant.
The next question is quite an unusual one from Rachie, and she asks, have you ever wondered what it would be like if Wallace was Prime Minister, and what laws would he pass if elected?
Well, it would be brilliant if Wallace was Prime Minister. I think he would probably nationalise all the cheese mines in the country, especially around Wensleydale, and probably have compulsory cheese eating for everyone on school, 18 and above. So, yes. But Gordon Brown and Tony Blair have been likened to, when Gordon Brown was Chancellor, have been likened to Wallace and Gromit. I think they were called Wallet and Grimace because of Tony Blair's big smile.
So Nick, thanks for coming in today and answering some questions for us. I'm sure the members of the website will be really pleased. But before you go, I know we've got a lot of artists on the website, and I wondered if you could kind of do a little sketch for us just to show everyone how it's done.
Sure, yeah. Okay. So yes, the rocket. Okay, so we have this large, very fat cigar shape to about there with a point at the top. I don't know how accurately I can draw this, but the band around the middle is important, and then it comes a bit thinner at the bottom. It's got a round underneath, and that's where the jet comes out. It's very much based on a 50s style rocket you see in old sci-fi films and cartoons. And it's got these kind of ribs all the way around that look like metal panels, but it's actually, I built the original one at college making a cardboard sort of skeleton that was quite strong, and then stretched to that tissue paper over it that you build model aeroplanes, you know, that fly, and then stuck lentils or split peas all over it to look like rivets. It was quite cheap to make, as I hadn't got much money to make it with when I built it, and I still got the original one. And as you can see, you know, there are different panels, you know, in the metalwork, you know, that you can put them anywhere just to make it look like homemade, you know, even the odd little patch, you know, that Wallace has put on it, you know, like a cartoon plaster where he's patched it up. But even, you know, the wings have rivets all over, just to make it, I love all that old-fashioned Victorian kind of technology. Just put a bit of shading in there, because that's dark underneath. That's the shadow it would make from this perspective. Just put a few more rivets on. And maybe even sometimes I just put a bit of shading in to make it look more 3D. And as you come around the front, maybe just slightly lighter, so that it looks like there's a side light on it. Maybe even slightly more there, just to give a bit of lighting, really. And I just put Wallace and Gromit in there. Gromit can be waving, as in a grand day out. There we go. Yeah, I'll sign it. There we go.